wouldn't be the star, and we'll divvy it up that way, shall we? Yeah, so there is a bit of a theme of clinicians doing research today, so I have decided to sort of take it a bit from that angle and look at the research process that I'm embarking on and how that's challenged me to think about how I practice clinically as a physiotherapist as well, so I guess the internet. And I'm hoping that today will provide a bit of an opportunity for us all to reflect on how we can maintain this questioning posture within our clinical practice. So it's always good to say what the main points might be. So I'm hoping that you'll see, as I've mentioned, and it's an extension of clinical practice, that my research, while in a really specific area, actually informs quite a lot of broader clinical questions. And hopefully you'll see that research can be a little bit of fun. Obviously I'm at the early stages still, so we'll see if Joe still thinks it's fun. It's also challenging and frustrating, but then that's what kind of practice is like as well in any other work, I think, so it's no different. So essentially, Writing for the Disabled of New Zealand approached the Wellington School of Medicine and to ask them to evaluate the effectiveness of therapeutic writing within the New Zealand context and influencing health and wellbeing outcomes. And then they approached me to do the work. I'm scared of horses, so I haven't gone into it with a horse, sort of strong, what's the word, I'm not biased towards horses being the best thing ever, but I think it's important to try and add a bit of, you know, a few puns to a presentation such as this, hence the title, Horses for Courses. And so when you're thinking about research design, I've been thinking about what is the best horse to use, and of course it's important to think about what the horse is being used for. So is it used for racing, which would need a different horse than jumping, than dressage, or a horse that's taken me around Punakaiki would have to be pretty slow, docile, and would need a lot of encouragement to actually get moving. Often the simple answer to the question of how you would evaluate is you'd pick some outcome measures, you'd have some people getting an intervention, some not, you'd make sure you get enough people to compare between the groups, you'd measure the outcomes before and after, and what I call some statistical jiggery-pokery would happen. And that might look like the thoroughbred design of within the evidence-based medicine field. So essentially, this applied research has overwhelmingly used within this field, so this non-theta group statistical designs, and I guess I want to say that they are incredibly helpful. So as I've discussed my options for getting treatment for bowel cancer over the last year, I've wanted to know what the randomised controlled trials have said. And these trials have actually informed my decisions about what treatment I have. One of the problems is that rehabilitation interventions are a little bit more complex and convoluted than a surgical or a medication protocol. And also I've had surgeons and oncologists that have helped me interpret the RCT findings so that I can work out what is best in my situation and my family history and disease progression, pathology, etc. The other thing is, interestingly, some of the outcomes that I considered important in my situation weren't really featured within the literature. So death rates and early ostomy reversal rates are all very exciting, but actually I wanted to also know about quality of life and bowel dysfunction afterwards, and what were the impacts on me. So that made the decision-making process a little bit fraught. So in terms of, if I was to pick a thoroughbred for my study, it really becomes about the study of averaged behaviours of individuals. And there's a real place for that, but I didn't think it was necessarily going to work in my situation. Partly because a controlled environment doesn't look like a clinical environment. Partly because there's limited attention to personal characteristics and environmental contexts. And partly because I think thoroughbreds are addicted to pee. And finally, from a pragmatic level, it's often very hard to get enough people in the same diagnosis? What's the ethics of no intervention? And if it is ethical, can you actually find enough people to form two control, matched control groups? This person, I don't think, has done a stylish writing course, because this sentence is very convoluted, but these are some of the issues that I've been thinking about as I've designed my study. The continuously increasing torrent of research on rehabilitation patients and their outcomes, including sophisticated randomised controlled trials demonstrating the effectiveness of certain treatments, is not likely to significantly advance our knowledge of the mechanisms leading to improvements, unless treatments become described by their hypothesised active ingredients, and the investigators offer a theory as to how those ingredients, through mechanisms of action, lead to improvements in those aspects of functioning they aim to improve. It's a long sentence. Now you can read it later on. So essentially, it's like just saying that's the question that I had, and I'm approaching it from a critical realist perspective. So I'm just going to really quickly talk about critical realism. I'm not going to go into the details because it takes a long time. But critical realism is essentially a philosophical perspective or a meta-theory that's developed in response to the limitations of sort of extreme positivism on one hand and extreme relativism on the other hand. And it's within the world of science, it focuses on causal explanations rather than just on predicting observable phenomena. And a key idea within critical realism is this idea of three domains. And within those domains, there's sort of three different ontological domains of reality. So there's the empirical, which is about aspects of reality that we can experience and measure either directly or indirectly. Then there's the actual events which have generated the mechanisms, and that's what happens in the world is actually not the same as what we can see and measure. There are aspects that we can't see and measure. And then the third dimension of reality is that there's these deep structures or mechanisms that generate the phenomena. And they can't be apprehended directly, but can be inferred through a combination of empirical investigation and theory construction. So that in terms of a mixed methods design, that's how they explain why you can measure both. So essentially they're saying there's a reality independent of our knowledge of it, and this reality is not something that can be immediately fixed or empirically accessible. What this looks like in practice is that you need to take into account the deep structures with their underlying mechanisms to gain a fuller understanding of the world. And within evaluation research, a critical realist approach has the goal of explaining the outcomes that you measure. So what it looks like is I've had to adopt a three-day eventing course that's good at all sorts of different things. And this is a bit of a brief snapshot view of my PhD study. So three phases, snapshot change and deduction and the synthesis phase at the end, and I'm going to go through each of those phases in a little bit of detail. Essentially, my aim with the research is not to ask if a treatment or therapeutic writing can work under specific controlled conditions, like can it work, but no. Rather, does it work in practice? For whom does it work? And under what conditions does it work? And I'm also wanting to make sure I do this in a manner that respects the individuality and the context of every person who accesses the intervention. And as you can imagine, there's a wide range of personal individuals and contexts. So phase one I've actually completed, and I'm not going to go through the results because that's an hour-long presentation in itself, but I've looked at why do people access writing for the disabled, what are the perceived benefits of therapeutic writing, and what is the intervention. And essentially the results, I'm also starting to think about what outcomes will I measure for the data, measurement database. So the two sort of areas I've talked about within the results are the perceived benefits of therapeutic writing intervention, so from various perspectives, really talked about more within the ICF domains, And then what's the description of the therapeutic riding intervention? How does that relate to international literature? And what are factors that can influence the diversity within its delivery? So that it's not just pony rides that you might see at a fair, but that it's a therapeutic intervention that's tailored to individuals. I guess from a clinical perspective, one thing that's really I've been thinking a lot about is our tendency to sometimes think about interventions as sort of a package, a bit of a blob that we place on person X, and then voila, out pops this changed person at the end. And so within the therapeutic riding perspective, we might see one rider plus one horse plus 1 hour session in a riding arena, and we wrap that and keep safe. And then out comes this sort of massively changed outcome. And it also happens in lots of other areas, and in my other experience with acquired brain injury, we see something very similar. Within this view, what is done to and for the rider becomes important. So it's all about, it assumes that the professional providing service holds the power. And I guess I've been challenged again to think about is it helpful to think that way when we're working alongside people with disability? And it's not just in clinical practice, the way we do research, I think, also assumes that this is a package that we're testing. And so our research processes are often quite reductionist in the way that they look at interventions, rehabilitation interventions. So I think we need to also think about interventions and how they work. And from a critical realist perspective, I think we need to think about the underlying mechanisms that might account for changed outcomes that can then be empirically measured. So phase two is very much about looking at those mechanisms, and it's a grounded theory study, which I'm just in the doing a recruitment for at the moment. And we're aiming to look at developing a treatment theory, which, as I've mentioned, looks at how and why changes happen, and what are the mechanisms for change. Specifically, how does therapeutic riding impact on day-to-day functioning outside of the riding arena? It's very easy to measure change that happens in the event, in the moment, but what happens and how is that translated? And I guess that has challenged, once again, my kind of practice. So just as, it's the same situation as if I was working in the post-acute rehabilitation setting, if I practice a skill in one setting, how is that translated to changes in the functioning at home? Or in a community exercise class, why do people who have had a stroke and come to this class experience a change in outcomes? Is it just because of what is done to them or what they do, i.e. the practice of physical tasks? Or is there some other factors at play, maybe change of mood, improved socialisation, self-efficacy, all those sorts of factors? So those are the things I'm thinking about for therapeutic riding as well. Want to look at what outcomes are important to riders and their families, and start to think about how I could measure those effectively in the population, which of course is one of the big challenges. Now, moving on to phase three, here's another good quote for you from Sir Francis Galton. Those who are not accustomed to original inquiry entertain a hatred and horror of statistics. They cannot endure the idea of submitting sacred impressions to cold-blooded verification. But it is the triumph of scientific men to rise superior to such superstitions, to desire tests by which the value of beliefs may be ascertained, to feel sufficiently masters of themselves to discard contemptuously whatever may be found untrue. I think he may have come from a positivistic paradigm, and I'm not aiming to get that far, not really even wanting to, but in phase three I am wanting to explore what causal relationships exist between the introduction and ongoing delivery of the therapeutic riding intervention. And essentially I'm going to use single case design, which can provide a strong basis for establishing causal inference. Now, I'm not going to go into enormous detail about single case design. I'm presenting that next week, and that's another hour-long presentation. But I guess one thing I wanted to say is that single case design can have a really valuable place within clinical research and what sort of happens at the coalface, so to speak. So essentially, within single case design, the individual provides their own control, and this systematic, repeated measurement of a dependent variable or an outcome, both before an intervention, during the intervention, and even potentially after the intervention. And then you actively manipulate the independent variable, so in my case, therapeutic riding, and this is where the multiple baseline comes in. So on this graph, this jagged line reflects the multiple baseline. So these three individuals received the intervention at various times, so you're trying to see a relationship between this introduction of the variable. And then you make comparisons both within the person and between people. So from a clinical perspective, single case designs are especially appropriate clinically. Unlike group designs, you can gain more information about who responded to the intervention under certain conditions. And that means you can get a more nuanced understanding of the empirical data, which tends to be lost if you're only reporting group means and associated effect sizes. The other thing from a clinical perspective is that the intervention can continue to be tailored to the specific needs of the individual as the intervention is delivered. And so the intervention isn't controlled per se, and it's not limited by the experimental design. So therefore it can provide a window into the process of changes. And there's been a recent resurgence for three main reasons. Firstly, in 2011, the Oxford Centre for Evidence-Based Medicine started randomised N-of-1 trials, so that's their term for single-case design. Notice that it's randomised. And they rank them as level 1 for treatment decisions in individual patients. So it's not making general decisions about treatment across populations, but in a clinical setting, they are as valid as an RCT. And there's also been the development of quality assessment tools and reporting guidelines, particularly over the last 3 or 4 years, which have really helped with the quality and consistency of reporting. And finally, there's been development of statistical analyses that can be used and are allowing for the combining of studies, which have added to the external validity. And that's been a significant critique of single case design up till recently. So my question is, can I include enough experimental control in my study? And I'm at that stage of designing it. And essentially, with single case design, you experimentally control mainly through within subjects, and then you control for external internal validity through the structure of your design, and then through the replication of the effect with different cases. There's lots and lots of questions and answers, and like I say, I could spend a whole hour on that, so I'm not going to go into it, but there's lots of answers that need to be found for how you make sure you've got multiple baselines, and can you add randomization to that, and how much do you control the intervention or record adherence to the intervention and all those sorts of things. One of the things that people often want to know really early on is, what are the outcome measures that I might use? And I don't know yet, but these are the concepts that are kind of boiling to the top of the pot. As I look across riders that come with lots and lots of different diagnoses, these seem to be ones that we could measure across diagnoses.
So you involve pediatric population?
I've decided to just look at pediatric at this stage. The numbers are higher in that group. There's less adults accessing it, so because the outcome measures are quite different for the different groups, I'm going to focus on children up to the age of 18. And then within a critical realist framework, the integration and synthesis is really important. And that's, I guess, where the clinical critical decision making comes, you know, who did and did not respond, and what does that tell us about, you know, who might respond in the future, but also how we can develop the intervention. So, and that leads, of course, to knowledge translation. So just finally, so what? Essentially, some things that I've been thinking about as I've gone through this process is how important it is to articulate the intervention, whatever it is that we're delivering, and to think about how what we're delivering induces change, and through that, how can we gain a better understanding of a practice. So for instance, if a mechanism of a therapeutic intervention, an important mechanism was therapeutic alliance or relationship, how could that be fostered to improve our outcome? If we understand that process a little bit, we can look at improving it. I've also been thinking about how do I know if I'm being effective? And I guess the thing I learned, one of the things I've learned from phase one is how important it is to ask why people even access the service. Not just what they got out of it, but why did they access it? So in phase one, most of the people accessed therapeutic writing because it was a valuable activity for them. They wanted a hobby, a sport, an accessible exercise option, all those sorts of things. Very valid reasons for accessing. The problem is that the people providing the service were always looking at it through the lens of change in body structure and function. So there was this great mismatch between the goals that were set and the outcomes that were considered important. And I've already talked a little bit about context and how important it is to think about the context that you're measuring outcomes and in what context you might see changes. So finally, it sort of really helped me to think about how I can sustain a questioning posture. So, you know, therapeutic writing, I'm probably not going to get involved in a big way, but in the future, there's some really transferable skills, I think. So I'm hoping that you've seen these 3 points are sort of part of my journey so far. Of course, it's been a little bit of a gather through my research experience today, but just to give you a bit of an idea. And big thank yous to my supervisors. I have a 4 at the moment, plus someone else we're consulting about single piece design. The NZLEA board have been incredibly supportive, both financially and in the general support. And the local Christchurch RDA team are an incredible group of all volunteers doing incredible work. Not one of them is paid. And then finally, Debbie and the Bale team have been incredibly supportive because it's quite isolating doing a PhD, and so being part of the Bale team, and I've got no supervisors here in Christchurch at the moment, it's been on maternity leave, has been really important. So, yeah, thank you, and any questions?